This is a review of Tesla's Battery Day. The screw-ups, the big points, what does it all mean? And what wasn't said, next on the Tinker Talks. This is big for a cylindrical cell. The Ice Age is over, and if everybody else doesn't get with it, they're gonna go extinct. This is basically the sentiment put forth by Sandy Monroe, and I happen to share it. What was shown on Battery Day shows a roadmap for one of the huge stepping stones necessary in order for us to get to full sustainability. We'll get to why that is the case later. First, I thought I'd maybe start with the kind of screw-ups, because a lot of the screw-ups had to do with the beginning of the event anyway. Firstly, the invitations. They only put one date and time on the invitations. The issue is that is that they started with the investor meeting, which meant that anybody who just wanted to watch the Battery Day stuff had to sit through the whole investor meeting because we didn't know how long it would last. They didn't give us a second time when the Battery Day would actually start with the relevant battery things. And if you didn't want to miss it live, you just had to sit through it. This was especially kind of annoying because you had all these activist investors who wanted to do some borderline crazy things, potentially even things that would cause massive international incidents, like sending a fleet of drones to monitor their suppliers, or putting a spy satellite constantly surveying everything. Yeah, I can see that not going over well. Well, at least they mean well. The second big screw-up was that they didn't show anything in person. Like, nothing. They didn't have one of those cells on stage. They didn't have prototypes of those products there moving around or doing anything. I would have at least shown one cell on stage. But if I could get away with it, I probably would have taken a bunch of these cells, put it into a power pack kind of thing, and then ran a big ice cream maker while the whole event is happening in order to sort of prove that they actually do things. I suppose you don't want to go too far because then people are like, oh, they're trying so hard, they're trying to cover something up. But Elon did say, I don't remember if it was after the event and tweets or what, but he did say they had a fleet of mules that were already driving around with these cells in there. They could have just driven up in one of those and said, well, this isn't just imaginary. This car that I drove up in is actually being powered by one of these. And look, you open it up and there's like a window and you can see the pack in there. That would have been awesome, but they didn't do that. The third kind of weird thing that was essentially a screw up was that they didn't invite anybody from the media, like at all. Some investors that make a lot of good content were actually there, but nobody from the normal media. And then Elon goes and says he was so disappointed at how the media covered it. You didn't invite them. You didn't stand up there with one of those cells for a great photo op and a thumbnail so that everybody can click you. You're very clickable, Elon. And you didn't just flat out say, here's the headline. If you had done like any of these things, it would have been much more likely that you'd get the kind of coverage you were hoping for. Not to mention, they don't seem to actually have a press kit pertaining to this event on their press page. You have to go to the Battery Day page, and then you can download like a static version of the PowerPoint that they presented there on stage. I think these are things that they should try to do better with in the future. The rest of the event was really good. The event had a lot of really good, really exciting stuff in it. They showed more detail than a lot of people expected them to. Not quite as much detail as I sort of wanted. I understand why, but I am that nerdy and so I kind of want to know. Okay, so here are the big points in summary. With less investment of capital and less investment of land, they'll be able to produce better performing batteries that are 56% less than what they are currently priced. They're going to utilize a variety of chemistries for different applications. Iron-based for low-powered and stationary applications. Nickel manganese for mid-spec stuff. I got the impression they were talking about electric vehicles with sort of medium range, not extreme range, but not low range. We'll have to see exactly what they mean. Time will tell. And high nickel for the maximum specification. The high nickel gives you the best range for how heavy it is. I don't remember them saying it in so many words, but it sounds like they may be eliminating cobalt altogether. At the very least, they'll be significantly reducing it. They intend on dramatically simplifying the supply chain, getting more and more things from more local or domestic locations and sources than ever before. the current paradigm has things being mined somewhere and then shipped somewhere else to be processed somewhat and then shipped somewhere else to be processed somewhat and then shipped somewhere else to be processed somewhat. Oftentimes, some of that material ends up kind of passing boats in the middle of the ocean. It's a little ridiculous. When I told my dad about this, he was reminded of the Brian Regan joke with the log trucks passing each other on the highway. I think I'll link a clip of that. And finally, a huge potential for increased capacity. Something on the order of 20 million cars produced per year, or 3 terawatt hours of storage capacity within those battery systems per year with cheaper, smaller factories. So what does it all mean? So what does it all mean? What does it all mean? So what does it all mean? Well, what it means is sustainable energy, security, and independence permanently, forever. These are the stepping stones that are necessary in order to get there. And this is a big one. This allows us to make systems that are healthier, cleaner, more reliable, and significantly cheaper for the rest of time. Materials used in systems like this are not created or destroyed while they are used. They can be reused indefinitely. Plenty of challenges exist to getting to that point. And finally, electric terrestrial transportation will very soon, in every conceivable way, be the least expensive way of transporting goods and people. Electric vehicles are, when compared with comparable vehicles, and sometimes even ones that are in lower market segments than them, are already, in total cost of ownership, less expensive. But some people can't see past initial sticker price. But even with that initial price, electric may end up being quite a bit cheaper than anything even remotely close to its capabilities in the rather near future. Tesla has now officially stated their intention to make a $25,000 vehicle. I'm not sure if that's a reference to the ones that they were announcing that would be designed and made for Europe in Germany, or the one in China. Maybe both. I don't know. Now to what wasn't said, but many people expected them to say it. I wasn't really one of those people, because I know of a little thing called the Osborne effect. So many people expected them to announce a million-mile battery. That got so ingrained in their minds over these several months that it took to them to finally get around to making this presentation, that when they didn't hear it, they freaked out. That was pretty evident in the way that the stock price changed. Or maybe it had something to do with the fact that they didn't actually show anything on stage in real life. That could have something to do with it too. Videos and pictures are nice, but a real thing that you can hand somebody and say, hey, here it is, it's real. It's a lot better. Now this million mile battery may actually be this battery. Or we might even sort of already have it. If you treat a battery very nicely, it will easily last 1 million miles. It's just whether or not that is practical. Having to keep the discharge and charge within a very specific band can make a vehicle less useful. But I feel they'll essentially have to have this kind of durability because the way that they're talking about utilizing these cells in battery packs is that in a very highly integrated fashion. And if you're going to highly integrate them into a vehicle, the battery absolutely has to last the life of the vehicle without any significant degradation. You think about how the semi-truck must be used. Perhaps those would be coming with very high warranties, or maybe they'll just be implied that they'll be able to last 1 million miles or so. Some automotive manufacturers have actually started marketing vehicles with extremely high warranties. I think giving extremely high warranties is a really good way to secure a lot of market share because essentially purchasing decisions are based off of two things, consumer confidence and emotion. Fleet sales is largely not based off of emotion, but based off of economics and politics. The economics of your product look really good if you can guarantee that they're going to get the sort of value out of it that they would like to get. And that can be achieved with a very good warranty. Why else might you think these batteries would really last that long? Because Tesla intends on using them themselves. Not just for selling products, but for selling services. I'm talking about their robo-taxis. That seems very much to be their long-term play. And if it is most economical to make the battery last as long as possible, along with the vehicle, then that is exactly what they're going to do. None of this planned obsolescence, none of this intentionally doing things so maybe they'll have to go and get service done. No. What would ever be best as a fleet operator? That's what they're going to do because they intend on becoming a fleet operator. So what do you think? Is it a big step or a small step? Is this extremely significant or just one company's kind of hype while other companies are moving rapidly in a similar direction. I personally think Tesla has a significant advantage. One of the main reasons why is vertical integration. They have a plan, a long-term, far-reaching plan, and they are very focused on accomplishing it. They push a lot of distractions to the side, features that other people have. They don't care. The main things that they concentrate on are things that help them get to that end goal faster. And if you've seen how they're building factories, fast seems to be their middle name. If other companies don't speed up, abandon all this nonsense, distractions, investments, and other things, they might get left behind in the snowbank of the Ice Age to be dug up at a later time, frozen in a block of ice, and people wondering how the heck did they get there. So anyway, if you ended up missing that and somehow sat through this entire video, I will have linked a supercut that shows most of the key information and important details straight from the horse's mouth. It's a lot shorter than the original presentation, so you might want to watch it. Thank you for watching. Hopefully I'll be able to keep up a more regular cadence of videos. I have a lot of subjects that I might cover, so if you're interested, try to stick around. Sub or something. I don't know. Bye.